Mossadegh's oil policy had miserably failed. No one was willing to buy oil from Iran. This was especially bad for Iran since oil was Iran's only income. Iran was facing bankruptcy. The Shah had given Mossadegh every opportunity to develop a profitable oil policy, but Mossadegh, unable to conduct a constructive policy, sank into destructiveness and depression. This is part 3 of our Mossadegh series, and today we're gonna talk about Mossadegh's so-called democracy. Now, even Mossadegh's followers had started to criticize him. After all, Mossadegh, upon becoming prime minister, had promised the Iranians an era of prosperity and wealth. But all they got were economic sanctions and looming bankruptcy. People who previously had supported Mossadegh instead were now shouting slogans like Merk bar Mossadegh, Mossadegh kunat deg deg deg, which meant death to Mossadegh. The message was clear. Mossadegh responded by banning media, arresting journalists, fearing increasing opposition from the parliament, and the Shah declining his request to dissolve the parliament. Mossadegh incapacitated the parliament by forbidding his followers of the National Front Party to attend the parliament. And those who resisted were beaten up by his terror squads. So much for democracy, huh? Anyway, due to oil shortfalls and the resulting enormous economic problems caused by his policy, Mossadegh now decided to print money worth several million dollars without sufficient gold cover, which basically meant high inflation. Does this sound familiar to you? Anyway, fearing opposition from the Iranian military, Mossadegh started to infiltrate the Iranian army with communists from the illegal Tudor party in order to strengthen his grip on power. Back in parliament, he even tried to curtail the powers of the king, Mohammad Reza, as the commander-in-chief of the imperial army, but did not even get support from his own followers. Seeing the parliament turning against him, Mossadegh first dissolved the Supreme Court and then finally also found a way to dissolve the parliament. He did this by calling for a public referendum. Of course, Mossadegh knew that the Iranians wouldn't let him abolish the parliament, so he manipulated the elections from the beginning. And those, he ordered that those who were against him had to vote in separate marked voting booths. This made Mossadegh know exactly who would vote against him. The population, being afraid of Mossadegh's assault groups and armed squads murdering them if they voted against him, voted overwhelmingly in his favor. The result was that 99% of the Iranians voted for the abolition of the parliament. This was so ridiculous that in some cities whose population was just around 3,000 inhabitants, one could even see a voter participation of 600%. Had the dead also voted in favor of Mossadegh? On that day, the Shah wrote in his memoirs, "Mossadegh systematically murdered people who voted against him to intimidate others from opposing him too." Mossadegh wanted to become an absolute dictator and had nothing else in his mind but to overthrow me and my dynasty. You must know that being a member of the former Turkic Qajar dynasty, Mossadegh had personal vendetta with the Pahlavi dynasty for overthrowing his family. Mossadegh, like many former elites of the Turkic Qajars, was a staunch enemy of the Iranic Pahlavi dynasty. The thing is, back then the Qajars enjoyed godlike status in Persia. All this while the Persians had to live in poverty as illiterates and beggars. All of this was now over with the rise of the Pahlavis, and Mossadegh, like many Qajars, had never forgiven the Pahlavis for the changes they had caused in Iranian society. And by mid-1953, the Iranians had finally understood that the goal of Mossadegh's foreign policy was only to drive the British out of Iran so that the Soviets could move in. You ask why? Don't you remember the communists who had supported Mossadegh earlier when Mossadegh let communists infiltrate the Imperial Iranian army? Exactly. The US, being aware of this and giving large amounts of loans to Iran, now was facing a dilemma. On one hand, the US didn't want to finance Mossadegh's insane policies, but on the other hand, they had to finance him so that Iran would not further drive into the hands of the communists. Mossadegh was a hypocrite when it came to his xenophobic attitude. On one hand, he gladly accepted American loans, but on the other hand, he was against any agreement with the United States. Instead, he threatened the USA if they did not continue to give him loans, Iran would become a communist country, and thus Iran sank further and further into anarchy. By now, most of the Iranians were staunchly opposing Mossadegh and demanded his abdication. Mossadegh reacted by putting the only person who could stop him, namely the Shah of Iran, under house arrest. This was because, according to the constitution, the Shah could depose the prime minister if the parliament had been dissolved. The Shah was legally allowed to replace Mossadegh with another prime minister until a new parliament was elected. Even though the Shah had finally gave the order to suspend Mossadegh from office, it was already too late. Mossadegh had already made a coup d'etat and was supported by the general Riahi, and thus further violated the Iranian constitution. With the Shah now imprisoned, the parliament and the court dissolved, and Mossadegh being basically Iran's dictator, Iran was now in chaos and far away from a democracy. It seemed like Mossadegh had won, and the Pahlavis were finally defeated. If you want to find out how Iran managed to liberate itself from Mossadegh, join us next week when we will be talking about Operation Ajax.